Good evening and welcome to the 24th meeting in 2023 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. May I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent and all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 3 and 4 in private. Are members agreed? We're all agreed. The next item on our agenda today is to take evidence on the Visitor Levy Scotland Bill from two panels of witnesses. This is our first opportunity to hear from stakeholders on the bill, and we're joined on our first panel in the room by Fiona Campbell, who's the Chief Executive of the Association of Scotland Self-Caterers, Stacey Dingwall, who's the Head of Policy and External Affairs at Scotland Federation of Small Businesses, David Weston, who's the Chair at the Scottish Bed and Breakfast Association, and Stephen Young, who's Head of Policy at Scottish Land and Estates. And we are joined online by Ben Edgar Spear, who's the Head of Regulation and Policy at Sykes Cottages. And I welcome our witnesses to the meeting. And we'll try to direct our questions to specific witnesses where possible, but if you'd like to come in, please indicate this to the clerks. And Ben, as you're appearing virtually, please do this by typing R in the chat function. There's no need for any of you to manually turn on your microphones, as we'll do that automatically for you. And I will begin with a bit of a context-setting question, which is that we've been hearing from the committee that tourist taxes are common across Europe. And so I'd be interested to hear your thoughts on that view that visitors' levies and tourist taxes are commonplace and don't seem to deter tourists from visiting popular destinations. And David.
Yes, that point of view is often put, and there's some truth in it, but a couple of points. One, here in Scotland and the UK, we have very high, compared with our competitors, levels of tourist taxes. That's taxes on anything tourists pay, by which I mean VAT on accommodation, which is the highest of all our competitors, airport departure taxes, alcohol taxes, and business rates and other things. And the World Economic Forum rated the UK 140th out of 140 countries in 2019 on tourism price competitiveness. So we're already very highly taxed as a sector. That's one point. The other point is that the other countries that have tourist taxes, and again, they all their other taxes are lower than ours, they, in most cases, are allowed to have their room price and then simply say at the desk, by the way, it's another €3 or whatever, payable locally. That's not legal here because we have to put any mandatory fees in the price unless the law is going to be changed on that. So, therefore, we would have to add that price into our room price, which is very competitive. And that's another point I'd like to make later, if you give me more time, in terms of how competitive tourism is. It's very transparent. People book through online travel agencies and they'll book a room of £99 rather than a room of £100. So the idea that it's not that £3 or £2 or £5 won't be noticed is not correct in that context.
Just before I bring you in, Fiona, could you just come? I just wanted to. So I didn't quite catch what you were saying about the. The legal piece, that it's not legal in this country. Could you just say that again or go over it again?
Yeah, and I don't remember the name of the legislation, but in this country we're not allowed to exclude anything that is mandatory in the price. So you can't, if you have a product that costs £100 and there's a mandatory extra fee of £2 that somebody can't avoid, legally you have to quote £102 for that product. And that includes travel.
Right, so we can't separate it out.
Can't separate it out unless fundamental legislation's changed. Okay. One of my colleagues may remember the name of the bill. I think it's in our submission, but I can't remember the name of the legislation offhand.
Okay, thanks for that. Fiona.
Thank you. Yeah, I think I absolutely concur with David that this proposed levy risks the competitiveness of the Scottish tourism industry, and it also ignores the fact that tourists already make a substantial contribution to our economy. It is absolutely true that lots of European markets have got levies in place, but they do not have our level of VAT. A new levy in Scotland would be an addition to VAT, whereas in 25 of the EU countries, they have a discounted VAT rate for tourism, so we are automatically being disadvantaged. And the financial memorandum for this particular bill doesn't estimate the financial impact of businesses if VAT is applied to the levy, and that urgently needs to be revisited. This is going to have a detrimental impact on small accommodation providers specifically because it may well push them into the VAT threshold that they have not met before. That is a significant problem for those small businesses. And a recent PwC report, which is called The Impact of Taxes on the Competitiveness of European Tourism, which I can happily share with you later if you don't have that. It was prepared for the European Commission. It found that tourist demand is highly sensitive to changes in price. So £1 in addition as a levy will have a majorly detrimental impact on the visitor spend.
Thanks. Stephen.
Yeah, I would agree with what Fiona and David have said. I think it's not, on its own, any policy is always kind of rational and makes sense, but we have to look at it in the round in terms of both levels of taxation and layers of legislation there. And I think there's a lot to be taken into account, both recent impact as well as long-term impact as well. So we have to look at everything together rather than just one single thing. The other thing I was going to mention was just in the BRIA, was just that there's not really much learning from those other countries as well in terms of what the costs of implementation are. There's a little bit in terms of local authority costs, but there's very little there as investigating for the operators what it's cost them and what their experience is around it. And also just generally, it's fine to say other countries have that, but what is the learning from that? What can we take from it? What are the good bits we can take from that? And what are the mistakes? Because there's always mistakes.
Thanks. Stacey.
I would certainly agree with what my fellow panel members have just said there. When we spoke to our members about implementing the tax, the two main things that we heard were that Scotland's already a highly taxed setting for them to operate in, and the VAT point was the one that came up most about being scared about being pushed over into that threshold. And to pick up on Stephen's point there, I think it's also important, you know, what economic context did those countries implement their levies in? You know, we're all very familiar with the current circumstances of our economy, the cost of living crisis. We all know that accommodation providers have not had to seek their challenges in the last 3 years. So I think it's really important to think about that context and what they're dealing with, trying to get back on their feet just now when we think about implementing any new tax or regulation.
Thanks very much. And Ben.
Thanks very much. Just to add to all those points, which I concur as well. When you're considering all those taxes in the round, so not just a visitor levy, which is, you know, common in Europe, when you look at all the types of taxation, those destinations with the highest levels of taxation on visitor accommodation, notably Amsterdam and Barcelona, have done so to try to reduce and restrict visitor numbers. Which I think is key, and obviously I don't think that's the policy here. And one side point on that with the with how people would respond to it and the price sensitivity. I know fellow panel members have done research on Scotland. We actually did some on the Welsh proposals for a levy based on Welsh government survey of visitors and residents in Wales. And only 50% of people who were likely to go to Wales on holiday said a levy would make no difference to their trip. And then the other half ranged between not being sure, to cutting back, to going on a day trip instead, to going somewhere else. And it all just seemed very, very risky for just a few pounds a night. And when we modelled the Welsh government statistics and their survey on a tourism sector spend of £6 billion, a very conservative prediction of the net loss. So after taking the levy, but then the cost in losing those people, the net loss to the Welsh economy would be £385 million. And that's around things like day visitors spending six times less than overnight visitors. So it's just that price sensitivity point.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm going to move on to the next question. Pam, actually, you wanted to come in on a supplementary on this? Yep.
Thank you, Chair. Good morning, panel. You have mentioned taxes there, higher taxes, VAT. My question is around, with obviously high costs of doing business in Scotland, which includes areas of business rates as well, regulations on short-term lets and many others, do you think that this extra cost on business is justified?
Fiona.
Thank you. It's a very good question. I think, frankly, this is the absolute last thing that the small accommodation and self-catering sector needs. We've just come through a pandemic. I don't need to explain that. We are being massively squeezed by the cost of living crisis. Recovery remains precarious. Our international visitors are coming back, but our domestic visitors are not. And that is a real problem because historically 70% of our market has been domestic. We obviously are facing significant costs, and those do include those associated with short-term let licensing and planning regulations, which are significant and considerable. Indeed, we could be calling this, we are shrinking our sector and then taxing them on top. And another thing I think that the committee should be cognizant of is how has this been modelled in terms of the BREA, given that we still don't actually know what the numbers are in terms of short-term let licensing. So, for example, Edinburgh has put a figure against how much they would accrue from the self-catering sector based on 12,000 short-term lets in the city, which was always a flawed number. Only 3,200 have applied. So either the modelling is incorrect, or people are operating under the radar, or people have closed their doors. So until we know those numbers, I think it's really important that we understand how that's going to impact the modelling of a levy.
Yeah.
Just taking a little bit further out with the kind of business regulation, I think there's a real messaging and signalling issue here as well, because we came through the pandemic and there was a really strong message of, you know, stay at home, holiday at home, spending money locally, that sort of thing. And now the messaging seems to be that somehow tourism in Scotland's a bad thing, you know, that it needs to be licensed, it needs to be taxed, it's not paying its way, it's not doing this. You know, we need to have a really strong message about the positive image of tourism and that we're definitely open for business and we genuinely want to grow this sector. I think that's the danger here, is that signalling that there's a problem in tourism in Scotland, which there absolutely isn't.
We didn't find blanket outright opposition to the levy when we surveyed our members. We did a survey at the beginning of the year, which about just over 50% were against it, about 20% were for it, and the rest were unsure. And then when we followed that up to have more of a narrative conversation with people, there was the concerns that I spoke about initially, but I think quite a lot of people were also looking at the opportunities that it might bring, because obviously there's going to be revenue from the levy, and the opportunity that revenue might bring to, well, you know, the preference was that it be invested in local infrastructure, things that would make it more attract the area more attractive to tourists. So there were certainly two sides when we spoke to our members, in terms of, I think there was probably an acceptance that the levy would come and a focus on how it could be used for good.
So Ben.
Thanks. Oh, I am unmuted. Thanks. Yeah, I think, you know, the sector, if it's accepted as an inevitability, will try to make the best of it. But I think if we accept that the sector is already highly taxed in different ways, and it seems to be a concern about making sure that tax gets to communities. So whether it's stuck in Westminster or it's in Holyrood or wherever, but the tax, if we accept visitors already pay significant levels of tax, then surely that's a separate discussion about how that tax is apportioned and is moved around, rather than setting up another system, another tax, with all the risks, inefficiencies and costs that go with that. So if you've got an admin burden and a cost of setting up a new system, reporting it, collecting it, it would be more efficient to just redirect the existing high taxation. And that's on top of the argument that increasing tax on visitors will likely lead to a net loss.
Thanks for that. I'm going to move on and kind of like, but staying in the same area, and I think Stacey and Ben, you kind of started to touch in on this, which is, I think one of the reasons that this bill is being introduced, this regulation, is around the impacts that are that mass tourism is having on our communities, and so I'd be interested to hear from any of you on what you think the alternative ways, and Ben, you're saying redirecting the high taxation, but how can we tackle the issues that are faced by communities when there's a mass impact on the tourism infrastructure and just improving things in the community if we don't do this, if we don't go this route? What are the other ways, aside from what you've already mentioned, Ben, around the redirecting of high taxation? Fiona?
I think what's really important is an absolutely clear understanding of what the policy objective is. This cannot be short-term licensing Mark II. We need to understand what we're trying to achieve. Is it to stop the impact of mass tourism, whatever that means, or is it to get some much-needed income for cash-strapped councils? But what we need to remember absolutely clearly is that any visitor levy is going to impact ordinary Scottish families and the rest of the UK when they're holidaying in Scotland. As I say, international visitors may be coming back, but we are seeing a really slow recovery for the domestic market, which makes up the majority of the stay for the self-catering sector. And price-sensitive consumers, are they just simply going to go to York instead of Edinburgh? Or are they going to go south of the border instead of stay in Scotland? Are we actually just cutting off our nose despite our face in terms of our tourism? We need tourism. We can't just have this assumption, as Stephen says, that all tourism is bad. We are absolutely reliant as a nation on tourism, and we need to be welcoming. And as Stephen says, we are facing a reputational damage here that could be absolutely devastating for Scotland.
Thanks for that. I'm going to go to Ben online and then come to David.
Thanks very much. I'd absolutely echo what Fiona's said. You know, it's thinking about the policy objective, unintended consequences, and it comes down to what activity do you want to tax. So I mentioned Amsterdam and Barcelona, where their cumulative taxes, were amongst the highest on visitors. And that's precisely because they're trying to dissuade people from visiting. So if we assume that that's not the aim here, we want to tax activities which don't contribute the billions that, you know, the figures are all out there for short-term lets and tourism as a whole. You know, it would be taxing empty second homes or disincentivizing land banking, levies that are taxing the negative use of land and properties, i.e. the opposite of short-term lets and other tourism establishments, which contribute so much. So I think it's just being very careful about what you tax, what activities, and how that might lead to different flows of people, visitors, and taxes.
Yes, I feel uncomfortable when we're talking about impact of tourism as if it's all a negative thing, and it's tourism something that's going to be managed down and it's all negative, because the vast majority, I'd contend, of the impact of tourism on Scotland's economy is positive. People staying in B&Bs in rural areas, their spend locally is keeping the shops going, the pubs going, the restaurants going, the local attractions going. It's supporting livelihoods. So we need to be really careful that that any policy interventions by the government don't sort of kill that golden goose. Yes, there are some negative impacts, but I'd say that they are very defined and in certain areas. And obviously the government has taken very, well, I would say drastic action already in the short-term lets licensing to overcome some of those impacts. But also some of the negative impacts of tourism are in things like camper vans, wild camping, cruise ship arrivals, day trippers who are not staying overnight and don't contribute much to the economy of where they're visiting. And so in considering a levy, I think it would be very distortive if those kind of impacts were left uncovered by a levy, and the levy was only applied to places where people stay overnight, which is the sort of tourists that are the most valuable to any destination, are the people who stay overnight. All surveys show that they spend most, they contribute most. So I think the government needs to be very careful that its policies don't damage the most advantageous forms of tourism and leave unchecked the most damaging forms of tourism. As I say, camper vans, wild camping, cruise ship arrivals, day trippers, all of those are impacts, and it needs to be looked at in the round.
Thanks very much for that. Stacey, you wanted to come in.
Yeah, I would just like to echo Fiona's point about understanding the reason why we are doing this. I think that's particularly important with regards to this one being the first kind of major regulation that's coming in after the publication of the New Deal for Business Implementation Plan. So FSB Scotland are members of that group, and you know that's the main focus of that group, better understanding why are we doing this, what's it going to achieve, and what is the impact on small businesses going to be. We've consistently argued that there needs to be more consideration of the impact on small businesses within the BRIA, for example. I think in this BRIA that we've seen, there was only two small businesses who would the VAT issue would have impacted them. So, you know, for us, that's not sufficient analysis of the impact on small businesses. So, you know, as I said, it's a really big test of that new deal that we have agreed. You know, if we get this one wrong, it's going to be catastrophic for small businesses. We already know that we lost about 20,000 in one single year of the COVID crisis. So with an industry that's worth 4.5 billion to the economy a year, 200,000 jobs, it's really important that we get this one right for small businesses.
Great. Thanks very much. I'm going to move on to the next question and bring in Mark Griffin.
Thank you. Good morning. I just wanted to ask a broad question, not so much about the content of the bill, but the consultation and engagement process, and to ask whether you've been satisfied with the level of consultation and engagement you've had with the Scottish Government as the bill has progressed from consultation to introduction, and the level of influence that you've been able to have on the proposals within the bill. And perhaps start with Stephen.
Yeah, I think you can never have enough consultation and engagement. I don't think we have seen that, to be honest. I think outside the kind of formal consultation, there's been very little in terms of kind of pre-legislative scrutiny, kind of working groups. Because I think one of the things that we've talked about is to say, well, if we're accepting this is going to happen, how do we make it work effectively? And the only way you can do that is actually to speak to the people who are going to be influenced by it and actually understand just the mechanism of physically collecting a levy, taking it and passing it on again. I don't think there's enough work being done on that at all. And as I say, as Stacey mentioned, we talked about a kind of reset of relationship with business, and I don't think that's the case here. We've seen it certainly in the short term less, but this is an opportunity to move beyond that and say, look, that wasn't very good. How do we actually get better? And I don't think we've seen a stepping up in terms of that kind of relationship building and that listening to industry.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with Stacey that this is absolutely the second test in terms of the principles of the New Deal for Business. During that regulatory debate for licensing, the concerns of businesses, specifically small businesses, were ignored and dismissed. And unfortunately, I feel like we're going in exactly the same direction. As you will well know, I've lived that debate for the last 7 years, and I can just see this doing exactly the same thing, and Scottish businesses simply cannot afford to be faced by the same unintended consequences as we've been faced with short-term let licensing. This is so critical on top of an already diabolical licensing scheme, onerous on small businesses. If we get this wrong, it's awful. And I'm delighted to be on the expert group for the guidance for a visitor levy, but that feels rather like the cart being put before the horse once again. And I feel like we need to actually look at the policy objectives, go back to the BRIA so that it actually reflects 2023 data, goes back and looks at small businesses, actually consults, and rather than listening, it actually needs to hear small business voices. And if that doesn't happen, then it just... But actually, right now, it just feels like a done deal again.
Anybody else? Stacey?
To just pick up my point in the BRIA, I think it would be worth going back and carrying out a bit more extensive analysis of the businesses that were consulted within that.
Okay, thank you.
Going to bring in Pam Gosol.
Thank you, Convener. In 2018, COSLA called for a tax on visitors and not on businesses, but it seems like this will have a substantial impact on businesses, particularly small and micro businesses that today you have spoken about. What's your views on whether this is a tax on visitors and not on businesses?
David.
Yes, that's a very good point. It certainly lands very heavily on very small businesses like B&Bs and self-catering operators because they will have to collect it. And this is really not a visitor levy, it's an accommodation tax that we're talking about. So it's an extra tax on their products. So a B&B will have to invest in and spend money in adapting their systems to collect a tax in their accounting systems. They will have to incur costs in collecting it. I mean, just simply the payment charges alone on card payments is roughly of the order of 2%. Just to take the payment, that's the cost, a cost directly to the accommodation provider. And then there's things like online travel agent commissions, which are usually between 15-18%, often much higher than that. So if you add all those costs together, there's a large part of that, of any visitor levy, is going to be a cost to the accommodation provider. And if they're not going to be actually physically out of pocket, they're going to need to be to retain all that monies to meet all those costs. But even if those costs are met, then this is extra administration and an extra burden on their prices, something added to their prices. We're all in a marketplace which is extremely transparent. So if you simply add costs to the price of your product, it means you've got you can charge less. It's going to eat into margins. So it is effectively, although the consumer's paying it, it's effectively equivalent to a tax on the accommodation provider as well.
Ben online and then come to Fiona.
Thank you. I'd absolutely echo what David's just said. We had it at Sykes in the last winter, cost of energy. If businesses believe they could have added a few extra pounds per night to deal with the increased energy costs in their short-term let, they would have done. But you know, they know that once you reach that inflection point where increasing price loses bookings, you have to level it off, and you can't. The reason people don't increase their prices is because they're already at the optimum level. And so, you know, we've talked before about the research that's been done, that you add a pound, 1% increase. I think it was in France, 1% increase in prices in the UK reduced the demand for tourism from tourists from France by 2.2%. You know, it is operators that stomach this. And that's on top of everything else that Fiona's already mentioned that they've had to stomach. So, as I said before, it's what activity do you want to tax? Do you want to tax the tourism sector and operators who are trying to bring visitors to the country, or do you tax, you know, 47,000 empty homes in Scotland, or underuse of land that's already been granted planning permission? So land banking. It's what? Why tax what is deemed a benefit to Scotland? It seems odd.
Thanks very much for that, Ben. Just to let you know that there is work being done on taxing empty homes, so that is a piece of work that is being worked on. So it's a piece of the puzzle, just so you're aware of that. Fiona?
Just going back to your comment, absolutely, this is going to be a huge burden, especially on the smaller accommodation providers. hotels will be able to add a system into their POS system. Small accommodation, small bed and breakfast don't have a system. They have a diary. So just the administration of this will be hugely burdensome for them. In terms of self-caterers, a lot of them are now using dynamic pricing. It will be very, very difficult to deliver this in a seamless way. A hotel would find it relatively easy. It would have a one-off cost involved in setting it up. But for small accommodation providers, this is specifically incredibly burdensome. So, you know, should we just do deliver this levy on hotels because it's easier? Well, they would say that's not a level playing field. But then it's also really important that any tourism accommodation overnight provider would have to go through the same burden. So you can't then exempt campervan hire, because that would, A, exacerbate the number of campervans on the roads. That's already happening post-pandemic. It's happening post-short-term lets closing down. This will exacerbate that yet further. If you then don't, they don't have to pay the levy, then they're not going to go stay in a campsite. They're going to go and stay in a lay-by where they're not going to get charged. So you've got to be really, really careful how this is going to impact on all of those different accommodation providers.
Sorry, can I come back in?
So,
thank you, convener. Obviously, listening to, there's going to be a lot of burdens on small and micro businesses, like you said. So looking for a solution here, obviously turning it around, how do you think we can ensure that there isn't major administrative burdens on small and micro businesses? How can things be helped and moved forward?
I have spent the last 4 years thinking about this, and there isn't a way. A lot of people will say there are other providers, but Airbnb does it all the time. Not everybody uses Airbnb. Airbnb is simply a marketing platform, a route to market. Lots of people, lots of David's members, lots of my members don't use any of the platforms or the agencies or anybody else. They literally go by repeat business, etc., etc. There is no simple, easy, non-burdensome way to do that, I'm afraid.
Okay, Stacey, you wanted to come in.
Sorry, I don't have a solution for you, unfortunately. But I just did want to flag that the additional regulatory burden is the biggest concern of our members. We already know that about a tenth of the members that we surveyed at the beginning of the year are already spending over 8 hours a week on regulatory compliance, so a full working day out of the business every week. And we also have heard in the consultation specifically, to feed into this, our consultation response, that some of our members were simply thinking that they were going to have to absorb the costs rather than, you know, add it on to the visitor. They were just going to have to absorb it because it would be too difficult for them to administer the charge.
I think in reality there isn't a way of making it kind of non-burdensome. It's something extra, it's something more you have to do. The only thing we have talked about that could make it slightly easier is a flat rate rather than a percentage. If it was per night, per head, then that is probably easier to administer than a percentage. As we talked about, you know, there's dynamic pricing strategies and things and different timings, and that could become really complex if you've got, particularly if you've got an operator who's got different types of rooms with different prices. And that then becomes really complex as to who's paying what. So that's the only kind of thing that could reduce the burden slightly, but it's still there. And it's the mechanism of having to do that that's going to be really, really burdensome. It's not per se exactly what it is, whether it's £1 or £100. It's the mechanism of having to do that, account for it, and then pass it on in a timely way. It's all added and it's all cost.
Okay, thanks very much for that. I'm now going to move on to questions from Marie McNair.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. What are your views on being an accommodation levy and not a visitor levy, as many visitors such as day trippers, wild campers, some motorhome drivers and cruise ship passengers will not have to pay anything? You've touched on it slightly, David, but would you like the opportunity to expand on your previous comments?
Yes, thank you. Yes, I think in principle any levy on tourism. And as I say, this is really what we're talking about today is really an accommodation tax rather than a visitor levy as such. But any tax on tourism needs to be, and we've argued that we shouldn't be introducing it now, but putting that aside, any tax needs to be a level playing field that needs to apply to all tourism, particularly high impact, high negative impact forms of tourism. So it would be perverse if, for instance, rural B&Bs were subject to a tax, whereas camper vans trailing around and overnight stopping in areas of natural beauty and everything were not subject to it. And as you say, cruise ship arrivals, day visitors to cities. So I think thought needs to be given to how to make a levy fair and to spread it wide, because that reduces the impact on any one sector, and it'd be unfair to single out specific sectors for an extra tax and let others be untaxed, because, as Fiona says, that would distort behaviour and make certain behaviours worse, like the camper vans, like the wild camping, which are going to have extremely negative impacts in rural areas.
Thanks. Fiona, do you want to come in?
I absolutely agree. I think I agree with David.
Okay. Yeah. Indicated he wanted to come in on this.
Yeah. Oh, hello. I echo what David said. We know that overnight visitors spend six times more than day visitors. And just to add to the point before about what's the solution? The solution is to, notwithstanding all the concerns about the high level of tax already, but to be honest, increasing VAT would be better than introducing a new tax, purely because you're not adding in that increased admin. So I think that shows how sort of strongly, you know, my fellow witnesses feel about it, is the level of admin. It's a double levy, because you've got the levy itself and then the admin. So yeah, increasing VAT would be better. But also, I agree that you need to look at every degree of localism within the bill makes it harder and increases the burden. So seasonality and different parts of a local authority and different events, you know, that there might be some justification in that, but there's areas of localism within the proposals which will make this much more of a burden for small businesses. So local authorities can have their own arrangements for how to reimburse. They can have their own local exemptions. They can choose how decisions are to be reviewed, for the periods of reporting to be quarterly or up to them. The form, the manner, and the information that to be included in the return can be decided by the local authority. The records can be kept for different lengths of time, depending on what the local authority decide and which records to be kept. And I can't see that how any of those are really... it's necessary to determine those on a local level, because they're just matters of fact. Well, do the records need to be kept for 5 years or 3 years? Why would that be different in Glasgow compared to the Highlands? It feels like there's so much localism in there for localism's sake, rather than reflecting a genuine local difference, i.e. Hogmanay in Edinburgh or the Edinburgh Festival compared to... And I think it's those... It's making it simpler is the one way that it could be improved if it is going to go ahead.
I'm going to go to Stephen and then Fiona.
Yeah, thank you. I think most of the issues, this all comes back to what is the problem we're trying to solve and what is success. And a lot of the issues around kind of mass tourism and the impacts that they have are around infrastructure or lack of infrastructure. So how do we put that infrastructure in place but not lay the burden of paying for that on what is one section of the perceived problem? I think that has to be taken into account. And there's also a lot of the infrastructure problems are not really tourism problems. They're wider societal and budgetary problems, because there's not, you know, infinite pots of money. So we have to look, it all comes back to what is success. And I suppose the success of this would be better infrastructure to handle the problem, so we maintain or enhance the number of tourists that we have, but we can handle them better and the impacts are reduced. So we have to be really, really clear on what we're trying to do. And I'm not sure that's coming through in the bill right now.
Fiona.
Yeah, I absolutely echo Ben's concerns. The localism element and giving the ability to 32 different local authorities to do 32 different things. We've got evidence of what that looks like in terms of short-term net licensing. It's an absolute car crash. So it would be an additional burden on top of a burden to then be in a certain local authority area which chooses to do things in a different way, which is slightly more regulatory difficult than another area. It's not working with licensing. Let's learn from the mistakes of licensing and get this right. So I think that's really, really, really critical. But it is absolutely so important to just reflect that this is a huge burden on small businesses, and that's a fact.
Thank you. Just moving on to my next question. Are any accommodation providers currently covered by the bill that witnesses consider should not be? Can I pop it to yourself, Ben, first?
I'm not sure that there are any in there that shouldn't be. I think there are others which should be. We've talked about, you know, camper vans and so on, and, you know, charging them at the point of hire because they're not. But if you're having it, I can't think of any off the top of my head, but other witnesses might have something to contribute.
Yeah, I think the one probably is moorings and boats. I think that would be extremely difficult to administer. Mm-hmm. If someone has a mooring, they're not providing accommodation and they're not providing that service. And they've also got no power to inspect the boat to see if anyone's sleeping in there or not. So it could be hugely problematic in that respect. You know, we've said elsewhere that cruise ships mm-hmm. would be too difficult to administer. I don't see the difference there. It's not a huge issue. I think probably the bigger one is, as we talked about, is camper vans not being in there is probably a bigger issue than things being in there that aren't. I think whatever we do has to be a level playing field and can't disadvantage some sectors over another. So in terms of that, just coming back to the boats and the camper vans, people hiring them out because they are providing accommodation effectively, not where they're parked, is probably a better way of doing it.
Thank you. Anyone else before the hand back? Fiona?
Did absolutely agree. I spoke to officials about this a long time ago and they said it was too difficult to include camper vans because they move. But the point is, if we're talking about a levy on the overnight, the accommodation provider, then the camper van hire operator would be the point of taking the levy and remitting the levy to the local authority. That's the only way of doing it. It's a very clearly very easy way of doing it. You wouldn't then pick up a camper van in Glasgow and pay the levy in Highlands, even if you go through the Highlands. You have to pay from the point of the operator because that's the accommodation provider. But that's simple. That's easy. So for them not to be included renders this an unlevel playing field immediately.
Thank you. Thanks, Fiona.
Thanks, Marie. But I think one of the problems there is, just as you use that example, if the camper van's hired in Glasgow but then travels through Highland, then Highland Council's not benefiting from the income there in order to tackle the issues and the impacts that the camper van's actually having there. So there's certainly something that needs to be worked through, and I think the government is taking that on board, but maybe that's not quite the solution. But there are other ideas, like, I think, licence capturing and that kind of thing, technology and things like that. So certainly it needs to be something that's thought through. But I think what we're trying to do is get the income coming to the local authority areas. Yeah, Fiona.
Can I just add to that? Yeah. And during a really constructive conversation with officials on that subject, they came back and said, but the problem is that's not going to capture personal camper vans. And I think my point is we've got to be clear about the policy objectives. Once again, this is not going to capture personal camper vans. That's not part of this bill. A personal camper van is not a commercial overnight stay. So I just think we need to remember what the policy objective, what the mischief is that we are trying to solve, and what success looks like at the end of it.
Thanks very much for that. David.
Yes, and just briefly, obviously you've made a good point about if a camper van is hired in Glasgow and goes into the Highlands aren't benefiting. But I don't see that as an insurmountable problem, because local councils could come to some agreement for apportioning money from that kind of hire across councils, and I think that to make it a bit fairer, and I think that would be a way of doing it. Because what we're saying is the practicality, the fairness, the level playing field means that those should be included, and it can be included because it's relatively easy to do so at the higher point. And then, in terms of the money going to different parts of Scotland, I think that wouldn't be a Yes, that is a technical issue, but I think between councils and with the government's help, that money could be transferred to allow for that, to allow for where camper vans are actually generally staying.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm going to move on because of time. We've got quite a few more questions to get into, and you have actually been touching on some of them, but I do want to give colleagues the opportunity to come in and ask them if they want to. So I'm going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us today. The bill includes a percentage rate, which would be for councils themselves to decide, and places no restrictions on what that rate might be. So I just wondered what the witnesses' views were on that provision, the pros and cons of a percentage approach compared to a flat rate, and what challenges you think businesses will face if that's set at different levels in different parts of the country.
Thank you. Yes, I think we strongly think that a percentage is the wrong way to go. It's extremely complex from the point of view of collecting it, and it's less easy to understand from the consumer's point of view. It's much easier to understand, and this would be a key to the success of the whole thing, that tourists generally, which include obviously Scottish people staying in other parts of Scotland, I don't know if they all realise that, but tourists generally, the success of the scheme would depend on a general understanding of it. And if it's known that it's sort of £2 or £3 a night, that can be understood and it can be easily worked out. If it's a percentage, that becomes very much more complicated from the provider's point of view, and we're the people who would have to collect it, and for the consumer understanding point of view. And I think that if you then start looking at percentages, and you know, we read things about Edinburgh Council talking about 6% and figures like that, and then you're staying at the Balmoral, you could find huge amounts being paid in a visitor levy. So I strongly feel that there should be an upper limit in the bill in terms of how the maximum amount it could be. But the key thing is it should be a flat, low rate, not a percentage, in my view.
For that, I just want to, if you've got something to absolutely add that David hasn't said, I'll bring you in. Stephen.
Yeah, I think it's just back up that flat rate, because part of this is Scotland markets itself as a premium holiday destination, as a premium destination. We've got high quality provision of accommodation, and this is effectively penalising providers of quality accommodation, which is slightly more expensive. And I think if we come back to what we're doing it for, and if it is around the impact of a visitor, well, the impact's probably the same whether they spend £10 a night or £1,000 a night. You know, it's so actually, what is the problem we're trying to solve? So, what we don't want to do is discourage quality premium tourism coming to Scotland, because that's what boosts the Scottish economy. That's what provides all the benefits that we're trying to keep here, while hopefully offsetting any of the perceived negativity.
Okay, thanks, Ben.
Thanks. It absolutely echo that. And I think it comes down to it would resolve the point about the camper van in Edinburgh going to the Highlands or wherever. It's a national scheme with a single flat rate, so people moving around understand what they're doing. It would be less admin. It would be clearer for visitors. It would be clearer for local authorities and owners that someone can just... And it would resolve any, you know, the more localism you have, the more confusing it'll be, and the more it'll put people off. So a national scheme with a flat fee would make sense.
Okay, thanks for that. Fiona?
Just very briefly, absolutely agree. And what we've seen with short-term let licensing, again, is rather than keeping the fees within the suggested rates from the Scottish Government, they've gone wild. In some areas. So I think it's really critical that there's a cap in the bill so that local authorities can't go wild and go to 6%, 7%, because that would be hugely detrimental to the Scottish economy.
My next question was with regards to flexibilities in the bill, and we've touched upon this in terms of potential for it to be levied just at certain times of the year. Hogmanay was highlighted Edinburgh Festival, I imagine, for Edinburgh City Council is one they would be looking at. And whether or not the panel think that's appropriate and would be useful, but also local exemptions. And I wondered what the panel's view was on national exemptions as well with regards to people who would be staying in hotels to provide work in that area, people who are providing care to a loved one, for example, visiting their children in hospital, visiting a family member in prison, and whether or not these national exemptions, which currently aren't in the bill, need to be taken forward.
Fiona.
Almost impossible to enforce. You might find that everybody's got a child in hospital suddenly. You know, we can't have that sort of thing going on. I know that the festivals are now seeking that cast and crew would be exempt. I'm now, an actor. Everybody's going to be an actor. It would be impossible. And in terms of seasonality, again, just an added burden for small businesses. If you turn it on and turn it off, confusion for the business owners and confusion for guests. Oh, but if I arrive on the 24th, I do get charged, but if I arrive on the 23rd, I don't. It would be incredibly difficult to actually deliver that administratively.
Mm-hmm. David.
Yes, it's very important that the exemptions are limited and are nationally sort of as a framework, and crucially that the local authority is in charge of them and deals with them. You can't have accommodation owners deciding on whether people are validly in hospital or not, or looking at their circumstances, policing them. Are they telling the truth or not? It's just an absolute nightmare. The local authority, if they want exemptions, they have to manage it.
So, helpfully, our members were pretty much evenly split again on the issue of flexibility or having kind of standard things within the bill. So, for instance, within the kind of charging model, again, people could see there were some who thought it would be advantageous to have a percentage charging model because that would allow for proportionality to be applied to the cost of the accommodation. But obviously, if you do that, you've got the whole burden of separating costs and stuff. So on balance, I think we kind of concluded that the national cap that David mentioned is something that we would support. In terms of the exemptions, that's certainly something that we believe there needs to be more information coming forward, particularly around the ones that are defined. How do you ascertain that? You know, how is it proven? And you know, there's certainly a lot of loopholes, as Fiona's noted, could come into that. So we believe there's quite a bit of work still there to be done. In terms of the flexibility around times, again, people were open to it, but again, there's always just the concern about, you know, the regulatory burden on the smallest providers. How do they cope with that as compared to, you know, a large hotel chain who have the infrastructure and staff to resource that?
Thanks for that. And did the panel know of any exemptions which are currently in place in different systems and how that's administered? For example, Edinburgh festivals provide a discount to some things for people who live in Edinburgh, with their council tax number being the key to unlock that. So wondered if there is ways of actually doing the administration to provide these exemptions, and whether or not that's a way of solving that problem. So someone who's booking, if they're booking it as a resident of Edinburgh City, who are probably the most keen on this being brought forward, whether or not that would provide an opportunity to actually provide that discount scheme.
I suppose, again, it comes down to administration. If you've got a large hotel chain that's got a system whereby you can put in a discount code, if you will, that's one thing. But if you've got a B&B owner that doesn't have that technology in place, again, you've got to be very careful about, if you've got exemptions, how you're asking the question, why are you exempt? You've got GDPR issues, you've got intrusive issues, we've got enforcement issues. It becomes more and more painful the smaller the businesses, I think.
Sure.
Stephen, and then Stacey.
The only one I can think of just briefly is the kind of island travel discount scheme for flights and ferries for residents on islands. But again, that's a very small number of large providers who've probably got the systems in place to deal with that.
Yeah.
To go back to the BRIA, I don't think there's been enough analysis done in the BRIA for a scenario like that, so we would certainly have to revisit and consider enough small businesses who may have experience of doing that before we'd be able to say there's just not enough analysis as yet, unfortunately.
Okay. Thanks, Karina.
Thanks, Miles. I'm going to bring in Ivan McKee.
Thanks very much, Karina. Morning, panel. See you. I was going to talk through the BRIA, because it's come up quite a bit over the course of this morning and explore a bit with you round about the numbers that are in there. And I know there's been some comment in this already, but to get your sense on the record of whether those numbers are accurate. But before I come to that, I just wanted to pick up on one other area which kind of adds complexity to this process, and that was round about the implications of the levy only applying to the accommodation element of a guest stay rather than other things that they're paying for as part of that overall price. So get your reflections on that and how that would work with those processes if you're booking through online platforms and the complexities that that might raise. Does anyone want to come in on that?
David.
That's a good point, and there's another reason not to go for a percentage, because you'd get into issues of extracting breakfast from a price and all of those kind of issues, which are extremely complicated for a hotel or B&B, whereas if it's an amount of pounds per night accommodation, that is simpler. Nothing is totally simple, but it's simpler to manage. Whereas if you're talking about percentages of a charge, much of tourism is that there's mixed charges. Obviously, breakfast is a key thing that's often in a room rate, and that would have to be somehow extracted out, and it's not as simple as it sounds.
Yeah. Anyone else on that? Steve?
Just quickly, I mean, Abrea's 2019, so the work's probably done 2018. Yeah. The world has changed massively, cost of living, COVID, all the rest of it. So I think there's issues there. The other thing I was going to say is that the BRIA takes into account and gives the examples of the turnover of businesses. There's no reflection of the profitability of those businesses. So you've got a £85,000 turnover example of a micro business and an £850 cost. Well, that's either fine or not fine, depending on what profitability is, and chances are they're not making any more than 5 or 10% profit, so it's a big chunk of that has gone, and then yearly, year on year, and licensing and all the rest of it. So I think more has to be looked at, not just those fairly bland figures that are in there in terms of turnover, but actually what is the profitability of the sector, because my gut feel and feel from our members is that it will have dropped significantly in the past years with all the extra legislation that's come in.
Yeah, I mean, just moving on to the period, just for the record on that, the implementation costs are identified as being between £150 and £1,000 for a micro business, and as high as £10,000 for some small and medium-sized businesses. So, yeah, I mean, just any further comment anybody's got on?
I think it was Stacey and then Fiona.
Yeah, I would say our main concern about the BRIA is that only two businesses who indicated annual turnovers below the VAT threshold were consulted as part of that BRIA process. And as Stephen noted, it was 2018, 2019 when that was carried out, and we saw what happened with the deposit return scheme when that was based on a BRIA that was carried out in the same time frame. So again, to go back to that point of learning from what we've seen in the last year, I think it's really important to revisit the BRIA as a result of that.
Thanks, Stacey. Fiona, Ben, and then David.
Yeah, absolutely concur. 2019, frankly, is meaningless right now. It's now 2023 and the world has completely changed. The short-term let licensing was based on 2019 figures that have been proven to be completely inaccurate. This is an opportunity to get it right. And as Stacey says, it's also an opportunity in light of the New Deal for Business to actually listen to small businesses. And that doesn't feel like it's happened to date. I think if this is to progress through Parliament, then the BRIA absolutely needs to go back to the drawing board and start again from fresh. And we need to look at it in the light of all the other regulatory landscape in terms of what is the impact of short-term let licensing and planning in terms of numbers, because that's going to completely change the modelling. So what is actually going to be the benefit accrual of a levy based on the existing numbers that we will know more about in the coming months and years in terms of the constricted small accommodation market?
Yeah, and one of the reflections on this is when you try and put these numbers on particularly a micro or a small business, you can calculate a number, but if the impact's on the owner's time, then it's not as simple as just saying it costs X, which chewing up a lot of their time, and that might reflect on their attitude to the business. So I don't know if you get any comments on just the admin burden apart from the notional cost impact of it.
Fiona? So
The BRIA in terms of licensing put nominal costs to the burden, the hours and hours and months of people's time that has been spent trying to comply with licensing is unbelievable. So the BRIA was completely inaccurate and therefore incompetent, and that delivered a very poor policy. So let's not do that again. Let's learn from our mistakes.
Thank you.
Very familiar with ambitions that the Scottish Government set out with an NSET, and you know it's not just about the time that time means that it's time that business owners are taken away from working on the business, scaling up, growing if that's what they want to do. So it's really important to consider that in the round, I think.
Absolutely. So David, you wanted in as well, yeah?
Yes, thank you. I just wanted to emphasise the point that was touched on about the VAT threshold. It's a very, very big significant issue in our sector, and the BRIA only had a couple of businesses that were below that threshold, so it was probably not giving a correct feedback on this. There's lots of businesses in our sector that deliberately trade below or up to the VAT threshold. It sounds perverse, I know, but it's a reality because of the rules on VAT, and because of the very high rate of VAT we have in the UK, there's a massive cliff edge when you get to 85,000. You've suddenly got to charge 20% more for your same service. So that's a lot of businesses deliberately trade up to that or under that, and actually sort of close sometimes in parts of the year in order to not breach the VAT threshold. It's very perverse. I've spent far too much of my time on Treasury, talking to the UK Treasury, trying to explain to them how perverse it is and that they ought to either have transitional measures or raise the threshold or something to allow, because that would open up more turnover in tourism and actually capture probably more VAT overall. But you know, the Treasury is the Treasury, and they always say no. But the fact is that that is a big issue, so it needs to be taken into account in this, that if the visitor levy on its own would push a business through the VAT threshold, how is that going to be managed, and is that business going to be somehow compensated for? Or is it going to be a total negative for that business?
Thanks. And Ben?
Thanks. So this is all for me about localism against a national scheme. So in terms of the impact on Sykes as a platform, which owners across Scotland and all 32 local authorities would list with us, in terms of the burden on us from an admin and financial point of view, it will be huge, but even worse if it's the more localism there is in there. So different exemptions, I listed them before, all the different ways that local authority can do different things, this scheme. Trying to talk to owners in different local authorities, and I'm learning 32 different schemes. That would be the burden for us. Things like the exemptions. Why would local authorities need to come up with exemptions? Surely an exemption from a policy perspective would apply at national level. Why would local authorities have different views as to different people who should be exempt in different circumstances? It doesn't feel like that level of localism is needed. Just quickly on the being able to prove that you're a resident. We talked about Edinburgh residents, you know, having their, that, you know, that's very easy to prove with your council tax bill that you live in a certain city for and get an exemption for a certain thing. But medical need and other situations are much harder to, you know, they're not as black and white in terms of, and also go into GDPR issues. And so that's, you know, why a national scheme where it's collected nationally, it's a flat fee that everyone pays, you know, if they're going around Scotland, they're paying the same amount per night across Scotland to a national body that's set up to collect the levy would make sense. And then they can divvy it out. So you don't need to have Edinburgh trying to make up for all the campers that it's rented out for people going to the Highlands, for the damaged Antilles, and they've got to deal with that at the councils. You know, if this is all about improving infrastructure, then on a Scottish basis, it can see where the biggest impacts on that tourism is having on local areas, and it can use the levy to apportion it out across Scotland, but collecting it nationally. That would seem to me to be the most sensible approach.
Okay. Thanks very much for that, Stephen.
Very briefly, I think one of the issues here is around you're taking small business owners and you're effectively making them into tax collectors. And they're genuinely worried about that. That's a skill that they don't have. It's something they're not used to. And if you look at the bill, there's 11 pages on the operation of the bill and there's 16 pages on what's going to happen to you if you get it wrong. And that is genuinely terrifying for small business owners. And I think that is one of the big, big fears we've got just now, is that a lot of this is focusing on enforcement and penalties instead of actually how do we make a workable system. And this is for small business owners to be made into, you know, figuring out whether somebody's exempt, where they come from, why they're there, are they medically, you know, what are they doing? That's a hugely difficult area to ask people who are trying to run a very simple small business, try and keep their life simple and try and survive. To put that burden onto them is huge.
Okay, thank you. Now I'm going to bring in Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Kevin. We've touched on the VAT threshold a couple of times. I just wondered if you've got any information on the number of businesses that operate just below that threshold so that we'd have an idea of the likely impact, and perhaps as well if you're able to say what the quantum of that financial impact on a business being pushed over that VAT threshold, what's the likely impact. Maybe come to Stacey first.
Just trying to find my stat. I'm pretty sure we did have that. I might need to come back to you on this If anyone has it, please do jump in.
David.
I'm afraid I don't have a number of businesses, but we can perhaps come back to you with more on that. I know that it's a very significant issue because we hear it so often from our members that they're managing their turnover to stay within that. And I've heard anecdotally figures that once you hit 85,000, you've then got to go to about 120,000 of turnover before you're... is sort of evened out and you're it's worth breaching the 85,000. That figure may not be, the exact figure, that's what I've heard, but it just gives an indication of that cliff edge is just so onerous, especially with VAT at 20%. If VAT on hospitality was 5%, as it is in a lot of our competitors, it would still be an issue, but it would be obviously a much less of a cliff edge than it is at 20%.
Thanks, Stacey.
It's actually in the BRIA. So there's almost 3,000 accommodation services businesses registered for VAT in Scotland, meaning their annual turnovers are above the VAT threshold of 85, and there are a further 2,000 to 3,000 smaller operators who aren't VAT registered. So that's about two-fifths to half of all of Scotland's accommodation providers.
Okay, those are really helpful numbers. And just to go back to David, I mean, I suppose it's anecdotal, but your view, or the view of members, is it would take a 50% increase in turnover just to cover the cost of going over that threshold, going from 85 to 120,000.
Yes, it's that order. It's not that you get another £2,000 or £3,000 turnover and you're back to where you started. It's a huge jump in turnover that you need, because we're obviously talking about turnover, not profit. And also there's the issues of that it's negative on your sales to increase your price so sharply suddenly. So yes, it is a very considerable burden, and it's very onerous when you hit that threshold.
Thank you. I'm absolutely bewildered. Did I just hear you say, how many accommodation providers did you say the total there?
Are registered for VAT. There's 3,000 registered for
VAT. And under VAT?
About 2,000 to 3,000.
Okay, so therefore the BRIA is completely flawed, because I thought there were 32,000 short-term nets in Scotland, so they're not in the BRIA. So that just kind of illustrates that the BRIA needs to be revisited, I think. But also the point I think that David is making is that we can't look at this policy in a silo. We've got to see it in the context that non-domestic rates have just gone up by 65% across Scotland, average of 50% for self-catering units. And at the same time, the non-domestic rate small business bonus scheme threshold has gone down. So suddenly people have jumped off the cliff edge into paying huge amounts of non-domestic rates. plus short-term let licensing, the costs associated with licensing, planning, all of these other things are coming at the same time. This is not the time to add another financial burden to small businesses, and that's what this is.
I don't know if Stephen or Ben wanted to come in before I move on. No.
They haven't indicated.
Okay. My next question was just around the process of introduction of a local levy scheme and whether witnesses agreed with the requirements that are then placed on local authorities, the duties that they have before they can introduce. So, you know, consultation with local stakeholders, impact assessment at a local level, the requirement to publicise a scheme, the requirement for government to then approve that scheme on, or whether members of the panel agreed with those burdens on local authorities, whether they think that that was enough, whether it's too much, or just views generally.
Stephen.
I think that there definitely has to be the consultation. There has to be a strong lead-in time to this as well, because if we are accepting this is going to happen and we talk about the burdens that are going to be placed on operators to put the systems in place, we have to make sure they have time to do that. We also have to have visitors educated in this as well as to what's happening and how it's happening, so that lead time is required, and there definitely needs to be consultation, and it comes back to the why are we doing it, and be very, very clear. And then I would go beyond that in terms of the burden, in terms of how it's then spent, which is maybe your next question, but I think there needs to be more scrutiny of that, because it's very vague as to what would qualify and what wouldn't, and we'd like to see a kind of committee with some neutral external members scrutinising what that money's going to be spent on, because any taxation, you know, nobody minds paying taxation to an extent if they see the benefit, but there's a real danger that this is a taxation which the people who are paying it never see it, never actually see the benefit, and it disappears somewhere else. I think we need that level of scrutiny and consultation to make sure we've got a really robust system for that.
Fiona.
Yeah, I agree. I think that's absolutely crucial, and particularly setting up that forum where there's meaningful engagement with small businesses in terms of how this money is going to be spent, the revenue. Colleagues on the ground who deal with individual local authorities who've been speaking to them about how they're planning to implement their specific bills have heard that some local authorities are keen to speed up the process, which we're quite concerned about, because I think it's an 18-month implementation period. Might sound like quite a long time, but I think we all know it could go quite quickly, so we would certainly very much caution against speeding up that process.
And Ben.
Thank you. I think what's critical is that we all know that local authorities are incredibly cash-strapped at the moment, so we tourism accommodation providers cannot help to set up these schemes. There's budget deficits all over Scotland in terms of local authorities. They're already incredibly strapped, but this is going to require some technological and administrative burden for them as well, and I think that needs to be reflected. But going back to what Stephen was saying, it is absolutely critical that we understand what this is going to be used for. It needs to be hypothecated and ring-fenced for something that is actually going to benefit the tourism infrastructure, not just going into general core spend. We fundamentally oppose the levy, as you'll know, but we absolutely agree if it is to go ahead, then it should be a national. It shouldn't have 32 different schemes. It should absolutely be simplified, and there should be a national cap. But fundamentally, I think we need to start again with the BRIA.
Thanks. Ben.
Just quickly on what local authorities need to do. The impact assessment in Clause 12 needs to have an assessment of the impact on short-term accommodation operators and other tourism and other businesses in the local area, in addition to local residents. And an assessment of the impact that it'll have on consumer behaviour and inbound tourism, both on in terms of the number of visitors, but also the amount that they spend. So if you're encouraging people to come for the day instead of do an overnighter, the impact on what they'll spend locally. And then the annual reports under Clause 18 should include an analysis of the number of overnight stays compared with the year before. So the year prior to the levy coming in, and now you've got the levy in, your report, having a look at the impact of the levy on tourism sector and tax receipts, frankly.
Thanks, Camilla.
Thanks, Mark. I'm now going to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to everybody in the panel. I just wanted to look perhaps finally at the funds that could be raised through the scheme. And Stacey, in your response to an earlier question, touched on this. The bill makes it quite clear that the net proceeds of the scheme should be used for developing, supporting and sustaining facilities or services which are substantially for or used by persons visiting the scheme for leisure purposes. Is that the correct approach to take? Because it doesn't specifically mention our business visitors that come to Scotland. So are they all correctly lumped into the same category? Is it the correct approach to take? And what are the potential ongoing benefits that we should be looking to see from the levy being deployed locally to develop those services? Maybe start with Stacey.
Yeah, I would certainly agree that that needs to be expanded to include business visitors. You know, that's obviously going to be crucial for some local authorities. So we would welcome that definition being revisited there. We surveyed our members in terms of what they would like to see the proceeds from a visitor levy, if it was introduced, what they would like to spend that on. And, you know, overwhelmingly, up to 2/3 were saying road maintenance, transport links, public toilets, bins, parking spaces, all those things that are crucial to attract people to an area are really, you know, business support was further down the list than those. So that kind of shows you where small businesses are in terms of thinking about the wider context and the wider community.
Thanks very much for that. David, to see your hand up there.
Yes, thank you. And we very much welcome the fact that the bill says that the proceeds should be spent on tourism-related issues. But, I mean, the big worry we have, I think the whole sector probably has, is that this could simply be used as a way of replacing existing local government spend for obvious reasons, and I totally understand how difficult it is for local councils and how cash-strapped they are. But this is not supposed to be the intention of a visitor levy to just replace existing spend. And so that is the worry. So I think that we put this in our submission, that I think the consultation processes in each area, sort of committees including representatives from the tourism sector, in terms of how spend should be allocated is really important, so that it can be on things that have some broad measure of agreement with the sector as well, that it is enhancing of tourism rather than simply replacing existing spend, which isn't supposed to be the intention.
Thanks, David. Stephen?
Yeah, thank you. I totally agree. I think that's the crux of this as well, and that there has to be some kind of additionality test effectively for things. I think that all the things that we're talking about are needed, but this has to be that tangible benefit that people are seeing, but, you know, the result of that. So having some sort of test in there to say, well, this is not just filling a hole somewhere else is hugely important. And again, that comes back to the messaging and signalling to the industry as well, that okay, if we're doing this, then we're getting a benefit from it, whereas a lot of time it would be really difficult to kind of feel that benefit.
Mm-hmm. Thanks. And the second part of this question, I think, is how do we demonstrate the benefit? Fiona, you were saying this has got to be ring-fenced so that it's clearly seen to be beneficial. Stacey, or did you want to come back in that previous question?
Yeah, sorry. So just to reiterate what's been said there, I think to go back to what we've mentioned about thinking about why are we introducing this policy, it absolutely can't be because local authorities can't afford to invest in these services as part of their routine budget. I completely appreciate the fiscal situation that they're in, but it's not fair to ask small businesses to take on this burden just because there's gaps in local authority funding.
Okay. So should the whole the record keeping and reporting and viewing arrangements that are within the bill assist us to make clear that the net revenues gained from this levy are actually delivering the kind of services that you're talking about? And Stephen, you said we might never see the benefit earlier, but should it be clearer that this levy and the revenue that's gained from it by an authority is clearly being spent on delivering those services? Fiona, you said we should ring-fence that thing earlier. Is that the view of the panel, that we should be clearer about how we do this?
Yeah, I think it's absolutely critical, given this is a levy on tourism accommodation. It's really important that any benefits from that are very, very clear and transparently used for benefits to tourism infrastructure. The difficulty is that local authorities have a way of interpreting things in a different way. So when I was speaking to City of Edinburgh Council's officials about this in 2019, I think it was, they said that they could use it for things like preschool care. And I asked the question, how is that helping tourism infrastructure? Rather amusingly, the answer was, well, those small children may be running tourism business in the future. Slightly tenuous, but that was the answer. So it's that sort of thing. So there could be huge benefits to this, and it could be done in such a way that, you know, I was just up in Skye last week filming with the BBC. Great experience. Broadford, amazing new toilets set up by their community group. If there are things that are set up that are clearly advantageous to both the community and the tourism infrastructure, then let's make it very clear. Let's say that this has been developed because of the visitor levy. Thank you, all the visitors. That gives them the ownership that they're doing something beneficial. It gives ownership to the accommodation providers that they're also contributing to something that's helping our visitors. So if we're really, really obviously, overtly transparent in what local authorities can and can't do with any monies raised, and then we use it as a positive message to both the local communities and also our visitors, then that would be seen as a positive. And you would get the support of the accommodation sector if that would be the case. But if it's just going to be going into core services, you're not going to get the support from the tourism sector.
OK. David, did you want to come back in again?
Yes, thank you. Just briefly to echo what Fiona said and add that... I think having support from consumers is a key to making this sustainable in the long term and giving it traction. And if the consumers feel that they're contributing to visitor levy that is helping enhance the destination in a real way, then there's going to be more support to it. And Scotland could then use that as to show that they're doing something very, very positive. But it needs that level of accountability and local proper consultation on how it's spent. And then, as Fiona said, you can have things that are developed physically in each destination and put a plaque on it saying this was built with the visitor levy and make it into a positive in that kind of way. What we're all worried about is it just going into a black hole of replacing existing spend on toilets or whatever, and then you get no benefit at all. It's just another way of replacing money.
OK, that's very clear. Was Ben coming there? I don't know.
I don't think so.
OK. Nope. OK. Thanks very much, everybody, for those responses. Back to you.
Yep. Well, thank you very much. It's been very helpful this morning to hear from you. I think it's been useful for us to get through those questions and hear your responses. And I now briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a changeover of witnesses. Still got Ben. For our second panel this morning, we're joined in the room by Sarah Allanson, who's the Policy and Membership Director for Scotland and Northern Ireland British Holiday and Home Parks Association, Neil Ellis, who's the Chair of Edinburgh Hotels Association, Margot Patterson, who's the Chief Executive of Hostelling Scotland, and Frank Whittaker, who's the Chair at Aberdeen City and Shire Hotels Association. And we're joined online by Simon McGrath, who's the Head of Communications and External Relations at the Camping and Caravanning Club. And I warmly welcome all our witnesses to the meeting. And we are now going to turn to questions from members. It's the same question, right? So actually, I'm going to start with questions. As in our previous session, we'll try to direct our questions to a specific witness where possible. But if you'd like to come in, please indicate this to myself or to Alan. And Simon, as you're appearing virtually, please do this by typing R in the chat function. And there's no need for anyone to operate their microphones on and off. We'll do that for you. So I would be interested in a little bit of context, and this may not be a question that you necessarily have a response to, but the visitor, there's kind of similar visitor levies and tourist taxes across Europe. And they don't seem to deter tourists from visiting popular destinations. And I just wonder if you have got any thoughts or experiences with that. Anybody? Sarah.
Well, some of the levies that have been imposed in places like Venice and Barcelona are actually designed in some ways to deter tourism. I think in Scotland, we're not ultimately trying to deter tourism. We're trying to encourage it, but perhaps in a more spread out way. So I think that's where we differ quite strongly from some of the other levies imposed across the world. I think that's important to point out.
Frank.
I think that I hear a lot of people say that they've been to Venice or they've been to Rome and the tourism tax was a minor part of their bill. And I appreciate that this isn't in the gift of the Scottish Government, but in the basket of taxes, UK hospitality taxed at 20%. There's only two other countries in Europe that tax at that kind of level. So if you look at it in the context of the basket of taxes, it is still an expensive tax burden. If you take that out and you go to a country where they only have 10% VAT, for example, then the tourist tax doesn't stand out and it doesn't look like an unreasonable burden. So I think that's an important point to consider.
Okay, thanks. And Neil, did you indicate
that was just
the point? Okay, great. Thank you. Simon, you wanted to come in.
Thank you. And yes, good morning. So from that perspective, I think as well, it's just worth considering how certain big cities, even within the own in countries such as Scotland, can also attract and will attract, you know, lots of tourists. But then what we also do from a campsite perspective is we want to encourage people into those more rural areas that also help support the local rural economy. So I think that can be a factor too. It's a comparison that's not very fair between, you know, a thriving city and all the attractions that go with it and a more rural countryside location. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that. And if we weren't going to bring in this bill, I'd be interested to hear from you what your thoughts would be on alternative approaches that the government could be exploring to help communities fund improvements to tourism infrastructure whilst tackling impacts of mass tourism. Anybody want to go on that one? Sarah.
I think that although I'd have to do some research into it, I think there has been some success in other countries with a voluntary levy. So perhaps at points of departure, say a ferry terminal or an airport, there might be a small QR code that you tap and you donate a fiver to the place that you're leaving. That would obviously have to be managed probably in a national pot and might be quite complex, but it could be another way to raise money. You could also do that at a local level, at specific tourist attractions like Edinburgh Castle that have really high footfall, just so it's not imposed on everybody and tourists feel like, you know, I've had a good time, so I'll put a fiver in, you know, kind of thing.
And then Neil.
UK Hospitality did a paper in 2019 where they talked about the possibility of hypothecating non-domestic rate collected from businesses in a destination to contribute to costs arising there. Hypothecating VAT remitted by tourism-related businesses. Review the justification for the small business bonus scheme, which provides exemption from NDR to over 119,000 businesses at that time at a cost of $254 million to create a more level playing field in terms of the cost burden. And then there's the air passenger duty. As we know, that's if you look at Lifeline flights from Inverness, one of my favourite quotes, and I really wish I could remember who said it, was there's nothing Lifeline about a flight to London to watch to see Liz Smith.
Thanks for that. Anybody else on that? Neil, and then Margot.
It was just to say that I think the introduction of any levy or any voluntary payment has to be significant. There's no point in doing something that's going to raise pennies. The actual administration burden to local authorities and to the collectors is significant. So without a substantial, you know, income coming in for any levy or any raised funds, it's pointless.
Thanks, Margot.
I would agree with a departure levy. I think that's a way to go. What I would see, though, someone coming to stay in Scotland, you know, from overseas, or you know, if there's messaging in train stations, there'd have to be some sort of indication as to what the money is going to, you know, go to. So they've had a great experience in Scotland, wherever that may be, and whether that would be the gift of the local authority to say, you know, this is our desire, we would like to improve amenities X, Y, and Z. It would have to be meaningful, so that if I'm a visitor and I'm being charged a levy, be it voluntary or compulsory, I just would want to know where it's going to, because remember, I'm leaving at that point, so with a hope and a desire that I'm going to come back to Scotland at some point. Thank you.
Okay. Great, thanks for that. I'm going to bring in Pam Gosol.
Thank you, Chair. With obviously costs being quite high to do business in Scotland, including business rates, VAT, which you have mentioned, and regulations on short-term lets and many others, do you think that this extra cost on businesses is justified?
No. And there's no reason for it to be a cost to business if the funds that are raised are given back to the businesses, so you're cost neutral. I think that would satisfy a lot of naysayers around the introduction of a visitor levy. The administrative burden, not only in manpower, but also the actual physical cost. I think if it was cost neutral, you would have a lot more people in agreement.
Yeah, I agree with Neil on that one. I think that is a lot of concern of people who are not in support of the visitor levy. We're recovering from the pandemic. Our cost base is already very high. To have any additional cost to businesses in any way, shape or form, it's not affordable. So we would need to be assured that, as you say, it would be a cost neutral to the business position for any introduction of such a levy.
Simon and then Sarah.
We campsites provide low cost, affordable accommodation, and anything that impacts that is obviously a great concern to us. And also just the wider elements of how such a levy will be collected, calculated, remitted, and that is a burden on the on campsite providers and all accommodation providers. So we believe that the focus should be on recovery and you know, making sure that visitors are, you know, fully welcome to Scotland and will be spending in the local economies.
Echo a lot of what Simon just said, because we're in similar sectors. Most of our holiday park members are run by small family businesses and are already stretched to capacity. They're struggling with recruitment, they're struggling with retention for various reasons, which we don't need to go into today. And to ask someone with no financial support to set up some kind of system, and to be frank, some of our members are not very technologically au fait, so they'd have to set something up from scratch. They're not being offered financial support to do that. That takes them away from essential daily tasks that they need to do to look after the holiday parks. And it's not really fair when they're already overburdened by several other taxes and costs of living and energy crisis and things. It's just another thing to ask. I think our broad position is that while we're accepting that a levy will come in, what we would like to do is make sure, and this is, I know, why you're holding consultations, is that it's shaped properly and the current form of the bill does not feel like it's going to, it feels like it's going to punish businesses. And I mean, you're probably going to touch on this later, but the enforcement section, sledgehammer to crack a nut, they're very excessive, in my opinion.
Thanks very much. Frank?
I echo everything that the other panellists have said. There is an interesting piece in the legislation where it mentions that local authorities can recoup their costs out of the revenue that's raised. It would only seem fair, if that's the case, that businesses should be able to as well. But I think that, as with any cost, it's about revenue generation. So the cost only becomes palatable if it isn't a tax on accommodation providers, but it actually is a clear route to generating more RevGen opportunities that drive profit flow, future investment, and all the positive things that come out of it. If it doesn't do that, it's a cost.
OK, thanks very much. Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Camina. I just wanted to ask a general question on the development of the legislation and whether you feel there's been adequate consultation and engagement, and whether you've been able to influence the bill as up to this point. And come to Sarah first.
I think these sessions are great. I think we were given a lot of time to respond to the consultation, the online consultation, which was great, and I think the call for views is great too. I just, you know, would like to be comforted that it was all being considered. I think what we've seen with the short-term lets licensing is that some of the consultation of that people felt was ignored. And I feel here we need to make sure that it's not, and it's all taken into account. And I know that's why we're here today, so hopefully we can make suggestions that are welcomed by the committee.
And just to follow up on that, I think the Scottish Government's consultation to date has been very good. EHA and Edinburgh Hotels Association actually had a meeting with the Minister, which was great to be able to feed into that part. In terms of the local authority consultations, I think a lot of the questioning that they're, obviously Edinburgh is working in parallel to this, the bill, so they're ready to go as soon as they're able to. I think their consultation and the one that's alluded to in the bill has to be meaningful, and it has to have a set of outcomes that come from that consultation, not just paying lip service to listening to industry, listening to business, but business should have a seat at the table. Those that have got the ear to the ground, that speak to the visitors on a daily basis, we're the ones that can help dictate, or not dictate, but that can help assure the money is spent in the right areas.
Margot.
I'd be very happy with the consultation. We actually had quite a few sessions with a researcher pre-COVID, and I think possibly because of our offering, you know, accommodation can be either a bed within a dorm or it can be a private room, and just really lots of conversations about, you know, if a levy is to be applied and it's a flat rate and it's a bed within, you know, a six-bedded dorm, in theory you could have six levies coming from six different bookings in one room, which seems punitive. So there was lots of early discussion. Of course, COVID hit and there was a bit of a delay after that, but, you know, I'm delighted to be part of the SDA Council, so again, through SDA, we feel we've had good consultation. But I do echo everything that's been said already. I think the crucial thing is, from today, the consultation continues, and actually the tourism industry is at the table when the decision making, you know, decisions are being made, when there's reporting coming from where the money's been spent. Thank you.
Okay, thanks.
Frank.
I think the consultation has been good and has been inclusive. I think the proof of the pudding as to whether it's been meaningful, when we come on to talk about areas in which the visitor levy can be spent and what that should look like, would be whether accommodation providers, tourism industry, is at the heart of that decision making once the revenue's been raised. If we're not able to significantly influence that, then this consultation wouldn't have worked. So I think that's how we know that we've been listened to.
Okay, thank you.
Simon, you wanted to come in.
Thank you. Just really to reiterate a lot of the points there, the consultation has been very good. And again, likewise, the Cabinet Caravanning Club has been engaged through the Scottish Tourism Alliance and working with our industry partners to better understand how this might work. I think, as the panel is no doubt seeing, there are an enormous amount of scenarios of different types of accommodation, different nuances within that. And I think the key thing on any outcome here is that it's a very fair and consistent approach across Scotland, as, so that we can point to that and say, well, it is very fair on the consumer, fair on the businesses, and all the local economies around Scotland.
Now going to bring in Pam Goosall.
Thank you, Chair. In 2018, COSLA called for a tax on visitors and not on businesses, but it seems like this will have substantial impact, which you've spoke about, on businesses, particularly micro and small businesses. What's your views on whether this tax on visitors... what's your views on whether this is a tax on visitors and not on businesses? And also, what do you think about what the solution is so that less administrative burden that you spoke about earlier on would be on businesses?
To pick that up, Margot and then Sarah.
Hi, I very much appreciate the challenges to micro businesses, particularly on the VAT threshold impact. For us, we have 29 hostels across quite a number of the local authority areas. For us, I believe it's a visitor levy, first and foremost. For us, the challenge will be, in terms of administrative burden, is if there is a different approach in each local authority, whether that's some local authorities don't apply at all, others do, and others have different rates or whatever. That's very difficult for us as a central sort of booking engine, central system to administer, and that's going to be a huge burden on us. So whilst I do believe it's a visitor levy, it's not a business levy, there will be a huge cost to us to administer this, and that I would like to know more about it to understand from local authorities what's that going to look like. Is it going to be a flat rate or what it's going to do? I support that it's a visitor levy, but I think we shouldn't be unaware of the fact that, someone mentioned, I was witnessing earlier, the 18-month lead time for anything is applied. That is really crucial because we are going to have to work out how we can make this happen. And the other thing for me is, in terms of the visitors coming to our hostels, it's all about that journey, it's all about that visitor journey. So if I start off in Edinburgh and the visitor levy applies, but then I travel to Argyll where maybe that applies there too, but then I come to Stirling, it doesn't, it's very confusing, I think, particularly for overseas visitors. And I truly believe our visitor base is mostly domestic at the moment. I don't think our domestic guests really realise this is coming, and I'm maybe going slightly off piece, but anyway, thank you.
Yes, sorry, I was sort of going to say something fairly similar to Margot. The holiday park industry is almost 99% UK domestic. It's improving in international, but obviously been hit by COVID like everything else. Although the demographic of visitors to holiday parks is going through a big transformation at the moment, it generally appeals to people from a lower socioeconomic background. And while a levy may seem small to someone else, it could be the difference between a four-day holiday and a five-day holiday for them. And that's, you were talking about impact on other, although they're technically visitors, they might only be driving an hour down the road, and that, everyone has the right to a holiday. So that's something to consider. I think we were quite strong in our consultation that the local authorities, although I know that they've been given more freedom, they've all translated the short-term lets licensing regulations differently, and they're all going to do the same with the visitor levy. And we have concerns about exemptions, we have concerns about how much, and we feel a lot of the decisions that have been allocated to be made locally should actually be made national. Like, should there be a cap? Yes. Is the percentage the right way to go? Probably not. Should be tiered. Otherwise, you're comparing Balmoral with a caravan park, and they're very, very different markets. So I think there's a lot of unanswered questions in the bill that hopefully this whole consultation would wrap up. But we're broadly in agreement with the STA approach of suggesting tiered.
Thank you. Just to sort of comment on the actual flat rate charge versus a percentage charge. The flat rate is far easier to administer for any business, even those larger hotel companies that have the ability to charge percentages via their property management systems to the small caravan and bed and breakfast operators who don't have basically working with a book. The percentage is overly burdensome for accommodation providers, and it becomes unclear to the visitor as well, and increases costs, and there's a potential for mistakes made by accommodation providers, and resulting in, which was mentioned earlier on, about enforcement action, which the bill is very, very heavy on. And at the end of the day, we want to deliver a successful scheme if one is coming in to everybody's benefit. And with regards to the administration, we were looking at potentially a twice yearly payment rather than monthly or quarterly, as what quarterly is mentioned in the bill. I think every 6 months would be, and to tie in with tax years, would be beneficial.
I'm going to move on, but just in the interest of time. Now I'm going to bring in Marie McNair.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, panel. What are your views on this being an accommodation levy and not a visitor levy? Obviously, Margaret, you've kind of commented that already. As many visitors such as day trippers, wild campers, some motorhome drivers and cruise ship passengers will not have to pay anything. Do you think the bill could be amended to capture visitors who do not pay the accommodation but clearly have an impact on the areas they visit? I'll come to yourself, Sarah, if that's OK.
Yeah, thank you. That's actually what I was going to mention a minute ago. We, our membership, strongly feel that half of the sector is being taxed and half isn't. Touring motorhomes is on the increase. The North Coast 500 is heavily marketed and they benefit from the infrastructure and they benefit from tourist attractions and all the other benefits, but they're not paying. And so what will happen is that someone who used to drive onto a pitch on a holiday park will now choose to park in a car park that may be supported by local authorities, which is frustrating for our licensed sites, or they may wild camp or irresponsible camp. Most wild campers clean up after themselves. Irresponsible campers leave broken glass, waste, that kind of thing. So for us, we feel that although touring motorhomes are mentioned in a later bill, they should be in the initial bill. And I understand that it will be very complex to include them, but complexity should not mean we just don't do it, in my opinion.
Thanks. Neil?
I would agree. I think the ship sailed to looking at charging day visitors. I think we have something that, and it's speaking on behalf of my members, that we think is coming in. And, you know, whilst we opposed the visitor levy to start with, if the money can be spent and hypothecated, as was discussed earlier on doing some good, then we'd be for it. I think the cruise ships, you know, berthed in the Firth of Forth, for example, I don't see, just because it's probably too technical to add them in, shouldn't be revisited. I think cruise ships do bring, you know, a lot of visitors to the city and a lot of other destinations around Scotland as well. But I think to start looking at people visiting, you know, for rugby or events, etc., would be a little step too far.
And sorry, Simon has indicated he wants to come in, so let's get him in.
Thank you. I think it's really just about keeping as level a playing field as possible and making sure that the whole system is fair, and clearly there is impact from day visitors to an area. We would always prefer someone touring an area to be staying on campsites. I think you know, that whole big picture does need looking at, because if you're just applying a levy to accommodation providers, there is that other kind of picture as well that is left unlooked at.
Anybody at Marvin?
Yeah, I totally agree with the other witnesses here. I do believe it's doable to extend it. And as Neil has said, just because it's difficult doesn't mean we shouldn't do it. I think for me, the key thing with the visitor levy is that it is simple and it's transparent. And it's just getting that point where, you know, I either go to the wild campsite or I hire my touring caravan or whatever. But it does feel very polarised at the moment that these other areas and other accommodation providers are not included. So I would very much welcome the inclusion or the extension of the bill to cover this. Thank you.
Other options are event ticket pricing, including some kind of visitor levy fee. Whether it's museums are free in Scotland, aren't they? whether it's His Majesty's Theatre in Aberdeen, P&J Live, SECC, you could add something onto a ticket price that is fairly inconsequential that would raise quite a bit of money. I agree the simplicity of it. It does need to be a national scheme. If you're talking about raising substantial amounts of money that is going to improve the visitor economy and our economy, then it has to be a national scheme. It can't be independently decided by local authorities. Just add too much confusion.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Marie. And we're going to move on to questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us today. I think one of my questions has already really been answered. I don't think anyone's disagreeing on the panel with regards to a flat rate fee if this goes ahead and not a percentage, and for that to be a national scheme. The question I wanted to ask, though, was with regards to flexibilities within the bill and levies being charged at certain times of the year and these being reduced or removed at other times, and just wondered what the panel's view was on that and any other local exemptions which or discounts which you would like to see. Neil, I'll start with you.
I think, to start with the exemptions first, I think the exemptions should be wholly administered by the local authority. To have a receptionist or someone front desk having to decide whether somebody is eligible for a rebate or a reduction in the visitor levy, quite frankly, just will not wash. We've already discussed earlier on today regarding the struggling to recruit staff, and this just adds an extra burden on to training and what identification is required. Does a blue badge exempt somebody, etc. So that the minutiae around that. So I think the visitor levy should be charged to everybody, regardless, and then claimed back from the council should it be appropriate that they're entitled to a rebate.
Frank, you wanted to come in.
I think it's really important that where possible we keep it simple. You know, the simpler the scheme, the simpler it is for the customer to understand. In the accommodation, in the hotel sector, we always think about the customer journey from the booking stage. So we look at how our websites are built and how the reservation journey goes and make it as easy as possible so that the consumer isn't confused. The bill needs to do the same thing because ultimately it is aimed at the consumer. It's not aimed at the businesses. So if it's easy for the consumer to understand, it's easier for us to administer and it's easier for it to be collected. So that's the thing. I agree with Neil. We get enough conflict at a reception desk at times, so we don't need to add another level of potential conflict. So any exemptions must be agreed in advance. Somebody should be, as part of the booking stage, be able to say that they are exempt, rather than turn up and say, oh, by the way, that doesn't apply to me. And then you end up with having an argument across the counter.
Mm-hmm. Hang on a minute, we can't hear you. Now we can. Yep, great.
So in relation to exemptions, I mean, one of the parts of the club that we operate and have operated very successfully for decades now is what we call our social camping. And these are temporary campsites that are run on different parts of the UK. These are run by volunteers. They're effectively camping for members, run by members. And it would be quite an onerous task on those volunteers who are sort of looking after the day-to-day running of that short-term campsite, up to 28 days and sometimes often as little as 5 days, for them to effectively have to, you know, calculate, collect, remit and possibly also audit a visitor levy on the people that are coming to the site. And that just feels a very onerous thing. So we just ask for aspects like that to be taken into account. And so far this year, we've had 82 of these temporary campsites set up in Scotland. Thank you.
Yeah, that's helpful. Margot.
Thank you. Just on the various points you raised, I echo my colleagues here in terms of exemptions. As a major provider of accommodation to school groups and lots of youth groups from areas of social deprivation. I would like to see the exemptions looked at again. I would like to see what other groups that could be added to these exemptions. I think you asked about seasonality. I am not a big fan of the levy going up during the main season. If you think about it, as accommodation providers, we're already flexing pricing to look at that. So if there is something in Edinburgh happening in August, then of course pricing is already up. So it's almost like we're sort of doubly impacting our guests who are coming to the city, and I use Edinburgh as an example, to spend a lot of money. So that's of concern to me. I very much would like to see a tiered approach. I think I mentioned earlier about the scenario where you have a dorm and we have six beds in it, and tonight there might only be two people occupying that dorm. So that'll be two visitor levies you'll get, but in the height of season there'll be six. So if it's a flat rate, which I absolutely support, but that would be six in that one room, which may be of total value accommodation of £150, it seems punitive. So I very much would welcome the tiered approach that I know SDE have also included in their feedback. Thank you.
Yeah, that's helpful. Thank you. And in terms of administrating these exemptions, for people who are potentially coming to Edinburgh, and as an Edinburgh MSP, this is my focus, to work in the city, to visit a child who's in hospital, here at the Sick Kids, providing care for a family member. We know the difficulties in getting people to help provide personal care in Scotland, and also potentially visiting a family member in prison from within Scotland. How do you see the potential for these to be exempt and a system to be put in place to provide that? For example, if it was me, to book that accommodation and provide my Edinburgh City Council tax number as proof of why I'm not, as an Edinburgh resident. Do you think that's something which we should look at and could be taken forward?
I think the example that you've given there with the council tax is a great one, but that would not account for, say, hidden disabilities, or perhaps you don't want to admit that your son is in prison and that you're visiting him, and then you're in an open reception being asked to prove things. So I think it's a bit of a nightmare to administrate that. Maybe of a slightly different opinion. Our members feel like exemptions should be nationally decided but locally administered. Is that what you meant? Sorry. I don't see how some of it could be checked. And that for me is a big concern, because then you're putting, as somebody said, a receptionist in an awkward situation of having to ask very private questions, and obviously there's GDPR to take into consideration.
Margot.
I would agree with Sarah. I think it could be administratively burdensome, but I mean, you speak of the council tax again. Just in that scenario, it could be a family coming from Glasgow to get specialist treatment in Edinburgh. And whilst I appreciate if you're a council taxpayer in the Edinburgh area, perhaps if the committee are going to look at that, they should look at Scottish nationals, because we all pay council tax. I think the other thing to say is everything's doable within systems, but the more I hear what Sarah's saying is, how do we verify that council number, council tax number? That's very difficult. So I think back to the nationally decided but administered from a local authority point of view. And the other thing I would say is, for our bookings, I would say the vast majority of our bookings are booked well in advance. So if we know what the exemptions are, we can of course publicise that on our website for anyone who is eligible, so they can try and get that organised before, because I absolutely agree, it's not our receptionist's jobs to try and decipher what's right and what's wrong. So we just need to be, it's back to the transparency and the clarity for everyone involved to know that if I have a sick kid or if I have a relative in jail, that I have that entitlement and that I can approach the local authority. But, we can publicise it, obviously, if we know it in advance.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for that. Thanks, Karina.
Okay, thanks, Miles. I'm now going to bring in Ivan McKee.
Thanks, Karina. Good morning, panel. There's a couple of areas I wanted to touch on. The first was to get your perspective on the complications round about the levy only applying to the accommodation element of a guest stay. And then following on from that, at some sense from you of the complexity and the time requirement for especially small operators to calculate and charge the levy, and whether that cost is accurately reflected in the BRIA.
So. Just to pick that one up.
Well, Neil.
speak for the small operators, but from a larger operator, your property management system, or PMS as we call them, are quite sophisticated and will be able to do that quite easily. But when you're looking at packages, for example, people visiting hotels or areas for Christmas or Hogmanay, where there's an element of food and beverages included in that, or spas, spa treatments, etc., it becomes very, very complicated to be able to drill down into an accommodation element only. So that would need some kind of, and again, the cost of adjusting property management systems, they're not owned there. You basically rent them, and the large operators will charge a pretty penny to make any adjustments to your systems. But again, it can be done.
I mean, just on the specifics on that, does that mean that there's it's nature going to have a lot of subjectivity around about how you would split up a cost, and potentially some debate, shall we say, about what we.
Well, I suppose you could say,
what wasn't?
Yeah, come and stay overnight, dinner, bed and breakfast, and, you know, your accommodation's £1 and your dinner's 99, you know, and then you're not paying any visitor levy. So I suppose it's how you decipher that.
Okay, thanks.
On Neil's point, a lot of the bookings for our members, and I would assume the hotel industry and hostel industry as well, are through online travel agencies like Booking.com and Hotels.com. They don't give things like that in a price. They'll just be a set price. So then one of the concerns that's come up with online travel agencies is how that commission is going to be paid to the business and then paid to the local authority and or government, however this ends up. But then you've got to rebuild relationships with your existing 10 relationships with OTAs, work out how you're going to do all that. It's another level of administration. So certainly I think all of the sort of accommodation industry benefits from packaging things together, and it's going to be really complicated to work out how that would go through the agencies, certainly.
Hello. I would just echo what Neil and Sarah have said. I mean, we too have this central PMS system, and we do split the costs out. The packages would be an issue for us, but certainly I would not want to see it applied to food and beverage or anything like that, because again, if people are coming in for lunch or buying coffees or whatever, we don't want anything like that to be considered. So we can split out the accommodation. It would need system development, and I seem to be saying this time and time again, but it's just the cost of that would be of a concern to apply that. Thank you.
Okay, and has anybody got any comments on the BRIA and the costs, the indicative costs that are in there for businesses?
Sarah? I think the BRIA needs to, if I'm frank, needs to be refreshed. It was done in 2019. I think they only interviewed 20 people and only one of them was a holiday park, so our members certainly felt very overlooked and not included in that. Holiday parks tend to be rural, and they interviewed a lot of hotels which are city-based and central, so there's no real comparison there. Obviously, it was pre-pandemic. The world's completely different. I think the BRIA needs to be completely revisited and the scope of it widened.
Lots of nodding heads there. Okay, maybe.
Thank you.
Great. Thanks, Ivan. I'm now going to bring in Mark Griffin.
Thanks. I want to come back to the issue of VAT that we touched on with the previous panel, and again ask a similar question. So how many of your members are operating at below VAT level of turnover, and what would be the kind of indicative costs for your members to be pushed above that threshold potentially by a visitor levy?
Maybe I'll just come straight. We're fully VAT registered, so that doesn't apply to us at all.
Okay.
Sarah.
I don't know if Simon wants to come on this one, but we have a number of members who sit below the threshold deliberately. A levy, since it's been confirmed, it would have VAT on it, would push them over. This means they'll either close, which is what we've heard from some people, or they'll reduce their season deliberately to stay under it. So then you're losing bed availability, essentially. So it could be very, very impactful. This is maybe slightly separate to the point, but anecdotally, we have a member based in England who has several really successful parks, and he was looking to buy one in Scotland. And when this started, he said, I'm out. Not interested, too confusing. So we've lost investment into the country as well. And I know that's slightly separate to your point, but that all contributed to it.
Mm. Okay, thank
Simon.
You.
No.
So the Camberley Caravanning Club is a membership organisation, and that's predominantly members who are campers, caravanners, motorhomes. So what I would need to do on that particular point about VAT, we do have a number of what we call certificated sites. So these are small individual landowners, perhaps a farmer, who run small campsites, no more than five caravans or motorhomes a night under existing exemption laws. So I would need to come back and advise the committee on that question, if that's okay.
Absolutely, that would be very welcome.
Okay, thanks. My second question was on the responsibility for local authorities when they move towards introducing a scheme on their consultation, their impact assessment publication, the responsibility of government to look at that and to approve or not, whether you feel those burdens are appropriate, whether they should go further. Just ask people's general views on responsibilities of local authorities when they choose to introduce a scheme. Frank?
I think that the bill needs to be really clear. It needs to specify precisely what the local authorities' responsibilities are. The biggest issue is going to be around how the funds are spent. And at the moment, that isn't clear in the legislation as to how the local authorities are going to make that decision. So they have to consult robustly on that within their local community once it's introduced. The 18-month notice period has got to start after the legislation goes through Parliament. You know, you can't have a local authority now saying we're going to introduce it when legislation passes, and that's the trigger of the 18 months. So that robust period of consultation is crucial. You're going to have different local authorities that are going to be introducing it for different reasons. And, you know, we heard in the earlier session, one of the panellists was talking about the pressure on local authority funding, and that is critical. You know, the local authorities have got their budget stretched. This can't be used to replace core services. It must be used to benefit the visitor economy. And how the local authorities are going to do that has got, you know, it's got to be clear as crystal. There can be no grey area in that as to how they're going to do that. And at the moment, I don't think the bill goes far enough in making sure that that happens. We are lucky in the North East in that we've got a very good and commercial DMO in Visit Aberdeenshire that is funded by both local authorities and then match funded by Opportunity North East. But a lot of the decision making is very short term because we're waiting on local authorities to announce their budgets in March. And so you can't have a long term plan in terms of how the DMO is going to be making the region attractive from a marketing perspective, because they literally are going from budget season to budget season. So if this is going to support the visitor economy, there needs to be a longer-term plan from the local authorities as to how the money is going to be spent. It can't fall into the annual budget decision-making cycle, if that makes sense, because this needs to be sustainable investment from which the visitor economy benefits.
Sarah and then Margot.
I think just to build on one of Frank's points there, the bill goes into quite a lot of detail about how it would enforce against businesses in terms of making sure that they were paying the levy and they were meant to, and in quite a lot of detail that I think a lot of us think quite excessive. There's no mention at all of what happens if a local authority doesn't report transparently on what the money is spent on, how often they're meant to report. There's no detail, so the bill at the moment feels very attacky on businesses and kind of light on local authorities. So I think, as Frank said, we need to have very detailed what is it going to be ring-fenced for. And additionally, holiday parks, as I said, tend to be quite rural, so it can't just be going to the usual suspects. It has to look wider, and that's where consultation with the wider industry continuing after this process would be welcomed.
Margot.
Really echo my fellow panellists here. What I would say is, in terms of the introduction of the scheme, it has to be very clear from the start what the levy is going to be, what the flat rates are. And I do hope, and we've said it all before, that it's a national decision, but it's administered from a local authority base. And I think what's also very has to be very clear is for how long does that apply? A lot of our bookings are 2 years out, and I'm sure it's true of others here on the panel. If we are going to apply that levy at the point of booking, where they pay, you know, 18 months a year out, I need to know what the levy is then, not what the levy is going to be in 18 months' time, because that's just going to become too complicated if a local authority decides. And again, I would like to hope that that decision-making is nationally made, that, you know, the levy goes up 50 pence a booking or whatever. Again, this is something that we just don't have the ability to be able to administer, and it adds to the negative, it creates a negative impact to the guest experience when they arrive. They believe they're fully booked, they've got that accommodation they wanted well in advance, and there's still a sort of residual fee to be paid. And I also echo the impact assessment. I think it's really important that local authorities on a regular basis see what the money has been spent on to the benefit of tourism, but also what the money is going to be spent in the next financial year and perhaps a 3-year plan, so that everyone is very clear that this is what there is a way forward, there's a roadmap, if you like. And so if we are asked by any of our guests or indeed within our sector groups, we know exactly what's going to be spent in which of our local authority. And I think just the last thing to say is consultation is key. Throughout, I would like local authorities to be talking to sector representatives, not just at the implementation, not just in the first year or whatever, but throughout the period of the time when accommodation levies apply on a consistent basis. Thank you.
Thanks, Margot. Frank.
Just to pick up on Margot's point about at the point at which the visitor levy is paid for by the consumer. If you go to Europe, you pay for it, it's applied and you pay for it at checkout, not at the point of booking. There is a slight complication there because is this a tax? Because if it's a tax, we are legally required to declare all our taxes publicly on our pricing, which means that when we put our prices up on our websites or on an OTA website, that price has got to be inclusive of taxes. That then leads to the complication of what level we're going to charge on advance bookings. So can the bill be written so that we don't have to apply that tax to our public rates and consumer can then pay it at their checkout? You know, it goes back to the point I made earlier. We need to keep it simple. You know, as soon as you complicate it, we've got problems for everyone.
Thank you. And Simon?
So actually, it's an interesting point there that Frank makes, because that just shows the breadth of complexity of what we're dealing with here. Because if you're on a campsite, you would mostly pay in advance. You might be turning up on the day to see if there's a free pitch for a few days and pay on arrival. But what you don't normally do is pay on departure. You pretty much pack up and off you go. And so that, again, is one sort of fact that we need to be debated and discussed. I just wanted to pick up on and echo some of the comments before as well in terms of how that money is ring-fenced and spent. And it's really important that the local authorities do consult with all stakeholders, whether they're the local businesses, whether it's the local community themselves as to how it's spent, and other stakeholders within that whole mix. Thank you.
Neil.
Just to add to that, we need to be cognizant of the fact that if the prices are all inclusive, then we're paying extra commission to the likes of OTAs on the actual levy itself. And then there's the additional credit card charge on top of the visitor levy as well, which is an additional burden. And there's also, I understand, the consumer bill making its way through Westminster. So just to be cognizant of that legislation in considering with this bill.
Okay, thanks very much for that. I'm now going to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, convener. The panel, you've covered one of the questions I was going to raise about making clear how the money is spent and benefits local communities. So you've made that perfectly clear that you would like to see that strengthened, I think, within the bill, to be able to demonstrate to the public that net revenues gained were for the purpose intended. And so on. So thank you very much for that. But just in the broad principle and the policy aim of the bill that I mentioned to the previous panel, it's to develop, support and sustain facilities or services which are substantially used by persons visiting the scheme for leisure purposes. Is that the correct approach in your view? Because that kind of assumes we include business travellers too within that,
that's our, is that the correct approach? So just Neil. A simple response on that. Neil, I see you.
To answer the directly, no. That business, corporate and association and sporting events need to be included in addition to leisure. Business events alone are worth £2 billion to Scotland's economy, and Edinburgh specifically relies really heavily on that. There's obviously a lot of community interest in the levy. In Edinburgh itself, you could spend it three or four times over. And again, it's about ensuring that the money is spent. Hypothecated, I understand there's a housing fund that you'll be aware of that ring-fences housing money that could equally be replicated to ring-fence the visitor levy money. So it's clear that it can't be siphoned away to be spent on other things. There's opportunities here. There's the Scotland Outlook 2030. Edinburgh has its own tourism strategy to 2030. The documents and the wherewithal is already exists on how we can spend this money for the benefit of Scotland and the local destinations. And it shouldn't be as a to replicate or should I say pay for statutory services. But it could also enhance the likes of the festivals, arts and culture that we so desperately cover in Scotland.
Thanks for that, Neil.
Frank,
you want to come up?
I think it's Neil's made the point, tourism is much more than just leisure. So we need, and from a financial forecasting perspective, in terms of local authorities forecasting how much revenue they're going to be raising every year, isolating just one element of the sector complicates that and makes the risk that the financial forecast is going to be much worse. If it applies to everybody, with the exemptions that the bill is proposing, if it applies to everybody, then you can generally, the local authorities will be able to go to somebody like STR Forecasting, for example, who will be able to say what their forecast for a destination is going to be in the future from a hotel perspective. So the local authorities will be able to say, well, this is how much occupancy we're expecting in this city over the next 12 months, and then they would be able to get a better financial forecast out of it. As soon as you start to slice and dice that, then that forecasting ability weakens.
Mm-hmm. Frank, you also said in your earlier answer to one of the committee members, that it needs to be more of a long-term plan about this rather than a kind of annual budgetary cyclic thing. Could you just expand on what you mean by that and what the benefits of that
would
be?
This is about this is pretty much about how the funds that are raised are spent. We all know that you can't spend marketing money today to get an impact tomorrow. So you need to have a long-term strategy for the destination. In our part of the world, in Aberdeen, we're advocating that the local authority would form a board, like a bid board, and that board would have a majority representation of accommodation and tourist providers on it, so that the decisions, it would also need to have community representation as well and local authority representation. But they would then effectively be working on projects in the way that a business improvement district does. And so you would be able to bring a project to that board. You would be able to identify a lot of places that board decision would link into the regional tourism strategy as well, and as well as what the local authority's investment strategy is going to be for infrastructure. And by infrastructure, I don't mean roads and toilets. I thought there was a very good example from the panel earlier where they talked about community pride. So where you have a local need for improved infrastructure, and I think the example was much better toilet facilities at a tourist attraction, then you could put a plaque up on the wall to say, from the visitor levy, so that there is a benefit and you get local buy-in. That local buy-in would be enhanced if you've got a local board making the decision, not just a local authority making the decisions.
And yet in the public, as far as the public's concerned, they should see the evidence of this quite clearly, that their money has been spent on these purposes or will be spent on these purposes over the next coming years. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah. A lot of us rely on visitors for our economic, for the businesses that we run, for the livelihoods of the people that work for us. So, we are in a very difficult financial situation post-COVID. Aberdeen City and Shire Hotels Association conducted a financial survey of our members earlier this year, and the vast majority were showing revenues better than 2019, but profit flow worse. and that was because the cost burden has increased. So if a scheme like this can generate clear revenue generation opportunities that improve the visitor attraction, improve how businesses can improve their own financial position out of it, you'd get a lot more support.
If that's everyone, thank you very much for your responses to that, Convener.
Great, thanks very much. Well, that concludes all our questions, and we really appreciate you coming in. It's been good to hear more nuanced approaches to your different sectors and how they'll be affected. So thanks very much for that. Next week, we'll be hearing from local authorities, and we agreed at the start of the public meeting to take the next items in private. So as that was the last public item of our agenda today, I now close the public part of the meeting.